Thank you. Now, this is one of these very rare, well, not rare, but it's one of these things of, so I haven't spoken to anyone about what my preach is about. Haven't told anyone. Me and Rachel actually haven't spoken probably about 3 weeks. That's our own personal fault, but we'll consider that. My sermon's called The Calm in the Storm. So it is God-given because there's clearly something that we need to be saying today. And also, I've had this in my heart for about a couple of weeks, and it's been things I've added to throughout the weeks. It's not one of these I've crammed it all in at the very end. It's been like, oh, I'll add that in. Points have been coming up, stuff like that. So, yeah, because normally when one thing comes into my brain, it comes out the other end quite quickly. So, yeah. So it is one of these, if God is trying to give you something, you will find it and it will come to you. It will stay with you. So that's enough about me rambling on because we all know I can do this for quite a while as my mum coughs to signify this. As I said, my title is The Calm in the Storm, which I feel is something that is very relevant to everyone. As Rachel's just said, like, you can go through tough times and stuff like that. You can feel that everything's just overwhelming. Like, I think we've all had days at work when we want to scream at colleagues, scream at the customers, or scream at children if you work with children. Hint, hint at some people. But yeah, it's, if everyone can please turn to the Bibles with you. If you have an actual physical Bible, you get bonus points and I will buy you something at the Chill Cafe. But you would have to say that. I don't actually think anyone has a physical. Who has? Oh no, we've got one physical Bible. That's one thing gone. But yes. So the story I want to read from is actually something Rachel's already mentioned. Is the calming of the storm. So it's in the Bible 3 times, which is one of these things of, you know, it was happening, and also you get the different viewpoints of all the different the authors, but they're all very similar. So we've got Matthew 8, verses 23 to 25, Mark 4, verses 35 to 41, but we're going to read from Luke 8, verses 22 to 25. So it says here, "Now it happened on a certain day that he got in a boat and with his disciples, and he said to them, 'Let us cross to the other side of the lake.' And they launched out. As they sailed, he fell asleep, and a windstorm came over on the lake, and they were filled with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, 'Master, Master, we are perishing.' Then he arose, rebuked the winds and the raging water, and then they ceased, and there was a calm. But he said to them, 'Where is your faith?' And they were afraid and marveled, and said to one another, 'Who can this be? For he commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him.'" So there's a couple things I want to like go into on this as well. First of all, we can all understand why Jesus would want to have a nap on a boat. This is a man that was very hardworking. We'd also, back in the day, this is before we had cars and everything that. I think most of us can go on a car journey if we're not driving and fall asleep and say, "That's 20 minutes, that's a 20-minute nap." Or like, for example, you can do a whole day of work, come back, and it'll be, "I'll take a nap, 2-3 hours. But yes, that's something that, like, things. So we can understand why Jesus would have a nap. The second point is the wording that they've used. So in all 3 versions, so in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they all use the same word, perishing. So perishing, which I think is a bit dramatic when you actually read what perishing is. So perishing is the adjective of perish, which is to die, especially in a violent or sudden way. So in my head, that kind of, like, because I've always thought, it's like, oh, it was just a storm type thing, so it was just a few waves. But the fact that they came saying, "We are going to die, please wake up, like, please save us," so I've now got like images of like these huge waves crashing over, like stuff like that, water going everywhere. And also, these are experienced, like, the people in the boat. Out of the 12 disciples, 7 of them were fishermen. So like, these are people that are quite good on the water. And it's not like they've not experienced a storm. I would like to find a fisherman that's like, "Oh yeah, every day I go out in the sea, completely calm, go out there, catch my fish, come back, that's it." So I highly, it's very doubtful. So these people are like trained, like seamen, basically, and are Like, they know how the sea handles, especially because this is their, like, their neighborhood. This is their waters. They will know them very well. So is it, yeah, so it's one of these things of, these are trained people, but they were still panicking. They were still like, we are going to die. Save us, Jesus. So yeah, my first point is, he is with you. So Jesus never like left the disciples when he went to sleep. He wasn't in another boat, or he hadn't somehow got to the other side of the lake already. He was there in there. He was in the boat. He was in the midst of the crashing waves and the raging torrents all around them. Jesus never left them. So why do we think that he leaves us when we go through these things? So we can have times where we think all the external things of the world are happening. Things are happening, like you'll get attacked by one side and then the other, then something else happens. It feels like it's never ending. But it's like we're still able, like we always think, oh, how can we move on? How can I do this? But he doesn't leave us. He's always there. He's always on the boat. So on the boat, there was nothing the disciples could do. Like I'd like to think that the disciples can't go out and just put their hands up and the storm finishes. That was something that God had to do. It was like God is on the boat. So when the waves and the rain came, God had to take over. God had to do it. God is on the boat. So he isn't leaving you. He's always protecting you. It may feel like that you want to pull the ejector cord and go like, oh, nope, that's me. This is too much for me. I want to step out. Like, God, take me away from this situation. But even to the disciples, he said, where is your faith? He said, "Is like, do you not trust that I will keep you safe? Are you not like in the, I am in the situation with you." God never left them. God, Jesus was always there. You're God's vessel as well. God lives within you, and everything that you do is through God. So like, you have to remember, God wants to keep you safe. If God is putting something into you, then he wants to keep you safe. It's not something that you're like, ah, yeah, you'll get on, you'll be fine. It's like, no, God is with you. He's protecting you. He's always like been there as well. So sometimes, and then also, like, I do like the fact is like the disciples were the ones in the thing. Jesus went into the back to have a nap, but the disciples were the ones like traveling. So we sometimes think this as well. Like, we sometimes think that Jesus, take the wheel. Jesus, you do everything. Like, I'll just sit in the back. I'll just sit and let you take my, I'll follow your path. You think, but no, we have to steer. We have to steer. I always think, I know it wasn't, but I like to think of it as a big, you know, the big pirate ships with the big massive steering wheels. So I always like to think that we always think, oh yeah, God's up at the helm. He'll have it. It's like, no, it's actually us. We have to do it. But Jesus is there. God is there. He will save us when we think. It's very likely that we are likely to go to thing ourselves into treacherous waters and stuff like that. Because I like this example as well of like the disciples were told a destination as well. So God, Jesus was like to them, was like, we're going to the other side of the lake. You got it? Cool. I'll speak to you in a bit. Type thing of that. So God left them to it. And basically, they could have decided if they really wanted to go all the way round the edge of the lake to get to it. But no, that's not how life works, is it? Because we are all impatient. We want to get things done. We want to get to the other side as quickly as possible. So we go, boom, there it is. I'm heading that way straight away. And then we're going to bring ourselves into dangerous waters. Things are going to happen. But we have to remember God is on the boat. And then the second point is ask for help. So as I've said a few times, God is on the boat. Well, it's not like the disciples just went, oh, no, that's it. We're gone. See you. Nice. Peace out. See you. It's been nice knowing you all. They went and got Jesus. I'll always like to think it's like, because the way that he wakes them is master, master, we are perishing. I feel it's very, like, it's the way it's written, I don't think it's how it's said. I think it would be like they've ran in, they've kicked the door. Master, master, we're going to die. Can you wake up? It's not going to be, yeah. If the water was happening and you were about to die, you're not going, Jesus, can you just wake up? We've got a bit of a situation. Can you help us a little bit here? So it's like, it is something, it's like we might have sometimes that it isn't our life isn't going to end. So we can just go, Jesus, if you can help me here, that'd be great. But sometimes we do think, oh no, I don't know what's happening. The water's here. The things are there. I've lost my job. I've lost my family. I've lost everyone. I'm just by myself. As like Rachel said as well, Job lost everything. But what did he do? No, he sat there. He spoke to God. He was like, no, thanks, God. if you can help me, I'm here. So it is quite easy to just go, nope, I'm gone, see you, bye. And then, so Philippians 4, verse 6 to 7. So be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your request be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and minds through Jesus Christ. So God will answer you. I bark on about this all the time, but it won't be on your timing. I'd say this all the time. I'd be married with kids. I'm one of these people. I'll have 3 or 4 kids, maybe. Well, we'll see. That's not just my decision, but yeah. I'm going to stop talking now. Yeah, so it is one of these things of God will answer you. It won't be on your timing, but you can ask him. You don't have to be shouting at him saying, Master, Master, I'm going to die, because I don't think me finding a wife is life or death. I might think it is sometimes, but it's not. So we have to remember that. It's me finding progressing in a job, it's not life or death, but it's one of these, God, if you can help me in this situation, I don't know what's happening, I don't know where I can go, but you can go that, you can just quickly and quietly ask him and he will help you. And then my third and final point, which I always do and I always love, is step into worship. So after the Jesus saves them from basically sleeping with the fishes that night, they then all marvel at him. They all worship him. They're all like, how can this not be God? How can this man has gotten up, he has stopped the waves, stopped the winds, and how can we not think? In my head, I feel like I'm numbed to how to magic and stuff like that, because we've grown up with Marvel, we've grown up with superheroes and wizards and all this jazz, because you see things on the TV off the boom, that this mic stand magically moves now, but it's no, that's not how it works in this world. But it did with Jesus. Jesus was able to stand up, go, okay, let's stop now. And basically the winds and the rain, they listened to him. And we all know how hard that must have been. We live in Scotland. We all know how temperamental the rain and the wind can be. I would like someone to go out there and say, okay, we can just stop now, just stop the wind. That'd be quite nice. I always say we have a Scottish summer because it's nice and sunny in the outside of the shade, but you go into the shade, feels about -4, and the wind brings it down to about -10. And that's when it's 20 degrees outside. So, yeah, so it is one of these things of, none of us can comprehend, even with all the technology we've had since Jesus' time, we still cannot control the wind. We cannot control the weather, but Jesus did. Jesus was in the boat, and Jesus could do it. So I always think you have to take time out to then step out and to speak and to actually worship God. I had to do this when I was writing the sermon. I was getting halfway through. I had to take a step back and go, actually, I don't know where I'm going. I was doubting myself, saying, actually, is this what I'm meant to be saying? Is this from God? Is this me? It was a flood of things were happening. I was getting overwhelmed. So basically, took a step back. Cranked up the worship songs, worshipped, prayed, sang very loudly, didn't have any complaints, which was nice. And then danced around, thanked him, and just everything he's done in my life, everything he's continued to doing, everything to do, it just completely thanked him for the situations and the fact that no matter how overwhelmed I can feel, I can just speak to him, and he is that calm, that what small breath, that small word into my heart can really just calm it, and it just completely changes everything. So what time we at? We got enough? How much time we got? Got enough time? Yeah. So in a second, I'm going to ask the band. The band are going to come up, and we're going to do one more worship song just before we finish. So I really just want to encourage people in this last song to actually really step in with your heart, open your heart up. If you feel, put your hands up, worship, pray, sing along, just enjoy yourself, enjoy God's presence, and really just do that. But just before that, I'm going to pray. I have the privilege that I can pray for you all. So I just want to remind you that God is in the boat. It's not just, you're not by yourself. You're not alone. Everyone, God is with you. Every storm that we go through, everything that we think, oh no, this is the end, I'm done. God is with you. Ask God. Just follow those 3 points of that he is with you. Ask for help and then step into worship. It is as simple as that. It can sound really complex that I don't have any magic words that I can say, yes, just say this and God will sort everything. It is one of these things of just step out, speak to him, and he will come as well. So, and if you've never heard these type of words before, if you want to know more about Jesus as well, I'm going to take an opportunity in a second just for you to give your life to him, to think, I'm not going to do some magical speech that light will come down from the ceiling and you'll be fully anointed and stuff like that. This is all from you. I'm going to say some words, the church are going to repeat them. We're quite used to doing that. And basically, within your heart, I just need you to just open up, say, God, I want to be with you. I want to learn more about you. And also then I encourage you, come back to church, learn more, speak to people. This is the best opportunity to do it, is speak to people around. You can look around here and there's a lot of experiences, a lot of like different ages as well. Some people have been walking with Jesus for a couple of years. Some people have been walking for their entire lives. Like, you can't go wrong with a church. Yes, we're all broken and messed up people, but that's life. We all do this because we all trust God. We all know he is in the boat. We all know he will be with us. Like, if I was left to try and do my life by myself, I would not be here. I would be in a completely different situation. God only knows what would happen. So it's one of these things of we trust God and we follow him because we know that he has the best path, the best things for us. So if everyone just wants to bow their head and close their eyes and just repeat after me. Dear God, I thank you that I can come here, Lord. Lord, that I can reach out, that I can praise you. Lord, that you are with me. You are in the boat. You don't leave me. You'll never forsake me. Jesus, I thank you. And God, I open my heart that you can speak a word into me, that you can change my life. Amen. Yes. Jesus, I thank you that we can stand together, that we can stand with you, that we can be with you. God, that you can come into this mist, Lord, and with your presence. You can really just speak into us. Lord, it might just be a small word. It might be a complete image, Lord. You speak to us in different ways. But God, we thank you. We thank you that we can have this opportunity. Jesus. Amen. Amen. So if everyone wants to stand up, we'll sing one last song.